youth climate activists are calling for the protection of climate protectors. For more on this, we have the spokesperson and lead convener of the Youth Advocates for Climate Action Philippines, Mitzi Jonel Tan. Good morning, Mitzi.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
Yes, Mitzi, let's talk about your group's call to protect climate protectors. What do you want the government to do?
So we're seeing that this new law that we have, the anti-terror law of the Philippines, is a very vague law where the definition of terrorism can lead to activists being tagged as terrorists. And there's precedent to this. We're seeing that in the world, we are the second most dangerous country for environmental defenders, according to the Global Witness. And this has been, we've always been in the top three for the past 3-5 years. Mm-hmm. And this call of us to protect climate protectors is to stand in solidarity with our environmental activists, our environmental defenders, those really at the front line, our fisher folk, our small farmers, our indigenous peoples. Because really, during this environmental crisis, it would be common sense to protect those who have been protecting the environment for decades now. But instead, we're seeing that they're being harassed, killed, and militarized. And as climate activists, as young climate activists, we don't understand why that's happening. Why are our environmental defenders, people who are protecting our forests and our oceans, being harassed and militarized, especially during the climate crisis?
Mm-hmm. You mentioned that climate protectors are being harassed and militarized. How many cases of this have you recorded? And can you cite which areas were this reported?
So the latest Global Witness report puts us at 43 deaths in 2019 and 30 deaths in 2018. The 30 deaths in 2018 was when we were the most dangerous country in the world for environmental defenders, and then the year after, that was when the numbers rose even higher. And it's across the Philippines, really. From what I remember, the 2018 one, most of the deaths came from Negros, with the killing of 14 or 19 farmers.
Mm-hmm. And how do you think can this be addressed?
Definitely the first thing would be to repeal the terror law, because mm-hmm. we know that it is a possibility. It is such a big possibility because there's already so much precedent that there could be abuse of power. And we're seeing that instead of having the indigenous peoples displaced, instead of having our small farmers met with violence, we could be listening to them instead. The very first the environmental defender killed under the Duterte regime was Gloria Capitan, an anti-coal-fired power plant activist who was a grandmother just wanting to protect her grandchildren from getting sick. And really, that's what we need. We need the government to listen to us, to actively include us in our participation in making policies. And that also starts with increasing and strengthening climate education so that citizens can actually actively participate and not just passively be asked about the climate crisis. But if they don't know about the climate crisis, how are we supposed to help in creating policies and enacting change?
Mm-hmm. But even without this anti-terror law, you mentioned that there have already been cases of harassment of climate activists. Are you satisfied with how the government is handling these cases?
I am definitely not, because until now we're seeing that there is no justice for our defenders. There is no justice for our indigenous and environmental leaders. Just this quarantine, so many have already died. Under the Duterte regime, over 200 environmental defenders have been killed. And it's just so sad to me as a young student, as a member of the youth, that this is happening to our people. We don't need this additional burden because we are already so impacted by the climate crisis. We don't need another thing added to us. We're not just afraid of the weather calamities, we're also afraid of our own government. They should be on our side.
Mm-hmm. And what is your group doing to arrive at that action that you wanted the government to do? Have there been communications between your group and government representatives?
We have been talking to a few Congress people, but really what we think is, and to the Department of Education, and connected to that, what we really think is we have to start with empowering the youth and the people with climate education, because knowledge is so powerful and empowering, and that is what can push us to action. So first, before we do anything else, in the student sector, we have to push for climate education. But at the same time, the government also has to call for a planetary emergency by starting with having a moratorium for coal, any new coal-fired power plants and reclamation projects.
Mm-hmm. Recently, President Duterte delivered a speech at the UN General Assembly, and he said or called on parties of the Paris Agreement to comply with its terms as developing countries like the Philippines suffer the effects of climate change the most. What do you think about that speech?
That statement is correct, but I am ashamed. It is hypocritical for him to say this when he hasn't been doing this. He hasn't been walking the talk for the entire time that he has been president. Instead, we're seeing that new coal-fired power plants are still being pushed. We still don't have our nationally determined contributions, which we need for the Paris Agreement. There are still no plans being made. Our climate policies don't include climate mitigation and adaptation policies. They're always just band-aid solutions about what happens after there's a typhoon or after there's a drought. It's not proactive.
Mm-hmm.
We're still seeing reclamation projects that are cutting down mangroves. We're seeing that our Department of Environment is prioritizing beautification projects like the Manila Bay white sand dumping instead of, you know, what we really need as a community, which is to really actively listen to the most vulnerable to the climate crisis, the most vulnerable to this massive environmental crisis.
Mm-hmm. Well, but at the same time, our country's contribution to the global greenhouse gas emissions are so little. What do you think can be done to actually make a difference in this effort to slow down the effects of climate change?
That's definitely true. Countries in the global south, like the Philippines, are contributing so little to carbon dioxide emissions. I think we are only contributing less than 0.4%. And that's why it's so important that we actively educate our communities, and that our climate education isn't westernized and technical and so foreign from us, because the way it's being taught now is very technical and it's very westernized. We don't even have a lot of resources in our own languages. And it's so important to empower our community so that we can all demand for climate justice together, so we can ask carbon majors to drastically reduce their carbon dioxide emissions. Because what Duterte was asking for, to comply with the Paris Agreement, it's not even enough. The Paris Agreement is not enough for us to survive the climate crisis. It might be enough for the global north, where they're not as affected as us, but it won't be enough for the Philippines, which will be sinking in 2050 if we don't do anything.
Finally, Mitzi, what can ordinary citizens do for the environment amid the lockdown?
The first would be to empower yourself with knowledge. There's so much resources online, and it can be very overwhelming because of how much information there is online. I would recommend starting with the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change Special Report 1.5. So this is where they tackle the 1.5 degrees Celsius target, the time limit that we have, which is by 2030. We have to get our carbon dioxide emissions in half. It is a long article, so you can look for summaries online. And then after that, talk to your family, talk to your friends. During Zoom meetings, talk to them, post about it, and really raise awareness with people, and learn and listen to stories of those at the front line. So there are videos available online. There are educational discussions being offered by progressive groups where you get to listen to the people most affected, our indigenous peoples, our farmers, our fisher folk, our workers even, our urban poor, who have so much to share about what's happening to the environment and to them. And so it's so important that we listen to them. And there's also ways to protest online through Twitter storms, I'm so sorry, through email storms, and through digital activism. There's so many ways now to go through that. There are petitions also. But we have to recognize that there is still a need to take to the streets, because that is where our power lies. But of course, we have to do it with proper physical distancing. We have to make sure that we are following the COVID-19 guidelines if we do this, and we have to assess the risks. And that's why our protest yesterday, there was so much that went into it, preparation to make sure that we were all following the COVID-19 guidelines, we were all following the university guidelines, and to make sure that everyone was safe throughout the entire action.
Well, thank you for sharing your thoughts with us. The spokesperson and lead convener of the Youth Advocates for Climate Action, Philippines, Mitzi Jonel Tan.
Thank you.